that I know that you are here, you've made it here, and if you have usually used the lift, you discovered it's not working today. So we'll get that fixed, and you can pass the word on, because I know that other people weren't able to be in the lift today. But pass the word on that we can do our best to have it fixed, and I think it will be by next Sunday. But our church's mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And the way we do that here is we love God, we love others, and we serve others. Yesterday was our chicken sale for our Mission Guatemala trip. And we were able to, thanks to you, thanks to the community, thanks to those who are on the team and our missions team who worked really hard to help organize this and to do it, we made $2,600 plus. So that was really great. So thank you, all of you, for your support of that important fundraiser. And I have a couple of young women here to share with you about Mission Guatemala. Are you going to bring the microphone? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mary Hogstead. I'm 16, and first off, I just want to say thank you so much for letting me just kind of be part of your church for a little bit to go on this mission trip. I've never been out of the country, I've never been on a mission trip, I've never done anything like this, so I was really, really excited when my Grammy told me that I could do this because I've never really done anything that I felt was like really helping someone. I've never done a lot of mission work, and I really, really want to because I know in Guatemala, that's a country that could use, you know, some help, some missionary work, and I'm really excited to do that and to be part of this. And you know, everybody has just been so nice, and I'm just so grateful. I can't wait to go. It's going to be very exciting, and I'm going to travel. I'm going to get to help somebody, people less fortunate than myself, to be able to preach. I mean, this is just a fantastic opportunity, and just everybody who has supported this, thank you so, so much. But on a side note, we did sell over $2,600 yesterday, but there are two chickens and two potatoes left in the refrigerator and downstairs, so if you want those, they're there. And we have extra cookies in the back, so you guys want to give us more money? So thank you very much. I cannot wait to go. I'm very excited, and I know my sister is too, so thank you guys.
Thank you. So 598 chickens was pretty good, wasn't it? That's how many we sold yesterday. And so if you don't want to have lunch today or supper tonight, there's two more left. I thought you might be interested, I don't know if I've told you this before or not, but you know that there are 18 of us that are going, and 9 of those 18 are between the ages of 16 and 25. So that's really nice too. We're taking in a number of young people with us to participate on this work team. Another way to serve close to home is Crop Walk. And Crop Walk is the Sunday the 24th, and Carol and Robin and Quentin are going to be taking your pledges, taking your names if you'd like to be walking. So that'll happen after the service. So please please stop again. Mike has a word for you.
Last Sunday I mentioned that all these people in the shelters because of the hurricane needed hygiene kits. So we started that project Sunday, and I'm coming to you again to ask to continue that project. This is what a hygiene kit looks like. It's got towel, washcloth, soap, fingernail clippers, band-aids in it, and there will be toothpaste added later. But there's still over 10,000 people in the shelters I read this week, and so we're still collecting money or kits. There's a box back here that either one can be put in. I want to make a first shipment this coming week, but we'll continue on because we can always ship them to Midwest Distribution Center and they'll use them where needed. But we have got over 13 of them ready to go right now. It'd be great to double that ship them middle of the week. So if you care to help us out, it'd be appreciated.
And you're welcome to bring those offerings, whatever you'd like to bring, whether it's a financial gift or the actual items for the hygiene kit, you can bring it to the office here. Another way of serving is the community meal. It's a week from this Wednesday, and there's a sign-up sheet in back for the items that you can bring in to be served at that meal. You can financially contribute, you can sign up and help. So check that out. It's a week from this Wednesday. Also, this Thursday is game day. I usually forget, but there it is. Game day is this Thursday at 2 o'clock. Check your worship folders for the announcements in back for the upcoming women's retreat and the new book that the Joy Breaks will be studying. Children's Sunday School still could use some Sunday school teachers. Talk to Barbie Gage about that if you can help. And as I look at my list, I think that's all. God is good. All the time.
God is good.
Let's worship together. I invite you to stand.
Lord,
and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome or understood it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. The Word of God for the people of God.
God, we thank you for your love.
We thank you for giving us Jesus that shows us how much you love us. Help us to turn to him whenever we are in trouble. Help us to turn to him whenever we are thankful. Help us to turn to him. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Back there, Mr. Schindler has the cards for you, so go back and see him. Thanks for coming.
All of these things we pray in the name of the one that taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
thank you, God, for a star that shines, for angels' announcements, for all of the ways that guide us to you. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our strength and our shield. Amen. This week we begin our reading of the New Testament. Woo-hoo! Did that come from behind me? For the next few weeks we will be focused on the Gospels, which means good news. The authors of the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, each share about the life and ministry of Jesus from their particular perspectives. So our chapter from the story is chapter 22, and it takes us from right before the birth of Jesus to his 12-year-old self. We read about how the angel Gabriel came to talk to Mary and to Joseph, and how they were unsettled at first, but then they stepped out in faith because they trusted. We read about how this couple traveled from Nazareth to Bethlehem, a distance of about 90 miles, when one of them was great with child, one of them walking, one of them having the option of riding a donkey, which I can't imagine doing at that stage of pregnancy. I did ride with my husband in a Jeep CJ7, really close to the end. I kept thinking that would cause the baby to be born, and I still really have strong memories of that about 37 years later. We read about Jesus being born, about the angel choir, about the shepherds hearing and going to visit, about the Magi, the kings, the three wise men, who came from far away in the east bringing gifts, and about Herod, whose plan was foiled by these three men. He wanted them to tell him the location of the infant. They went back another way. And so he was threatened. He had heard about the birth of this one who would be king. And so he sent out the order that every little boy under the age of 2 in Bethlehem would be killed in order to eliminate the competition. Then we read where 8 days after the birth of Jesus, he was taken to the temple in Jerusalem to be dedicated, and how the family met Simeon and Anna, who recognized that this was the Messiah and were so pleased to see him with their own eyes before they died. And Simeon offers this blessing to the family that ends with, "And a sword shall pierce your heart as well." And I can't imagine both the joy and the amazement of how their baby was recognized to be the Messiah, and then concluded with these words. And then we read again the next story about Jesus in our scripture. It's about the 12-year-old young man who was in the temple talking with the teachers there, and they're having this conversation, and it's an amazing conversation because he's talking with them like he's a peer. But the side story to the whole thing are that Mom and Dad had already started to travel back home, and they were gone 2 days, and all of the people with them and all of the family, it's like, where's Jesus? He's not with us. What? And they backtracked. They found him in the temple. Relief and whatever other emotions you would have with that. And I think this is one of the moments of evidence of the full humanity as well as the full divinity of Jesus was in his 12-year-old response. Didn't you know I'd be here at my father's house? Okay. It had to be really tough raising the Son of God. Raising kids is tough anyway, Son of God, wow. So the Gospel of John then tells the nativity in a little different way. The birth story is different. John is speaking to Gentiles, the Bible calls them, non-Jews, people who are not interested, not knowledgeable of Jewish practice, of Jewish tradition, of Jewish festivals. They don't know anything about that stuff. They don't care about that. But John knows that the message is so important that he wants to communicate the story to them in a way that they will listen, in a way that they will hear, in a way that they will understand. Now, I think that that's a really important word for us as we in the church today talk about reaching the new generations, other people for Christ. Because we get really familiar, really comfortable with the way we do things. We like it the way we do it. That's why we're here. We appreciate that. And yet we know how important, how compelling it is, how important it is for our children to know about the faith. So we bring our children. And yet we know that there are others in our community, out there, perhaps in our family, who don't know Jesus, who don't know about the faith. So sometimes it's important for us to think about, we love the old hymns of the faith. We grew up with them. We love singing them out. But there are others who don't know them, and they don't carry the same kind of meaning that they carry for us. We may prefer a particular translation, but there are other translations that maybe have an explanation or have words that will make more sense to a new generation. We appreciate the liturgy. We appreciate the setting. But for someone who's brand new to the faith, someone who doesn't have the history that we have, it doesn't make sense. And sometimes that can keep people from coming in and knowing about the faith, knowing about Christianity, knowing about who Jesus is. John knew that that message was so compelling that he didn't want to provide any barriers, any roadblocks. And so he was writing to non-Jews, to Gentiles. And because of him and his willingness to do that, and because of missionaries along the way who we will be talking about as we continue our study through the New Testament, because of all of them, we have come to know Jesus. We have come to know the faith. We have been included. So it's so important for us to think about that. Now John begins, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. To the Greeks, Word is logos. Word is reason. Word is the center for existence, the center from which everything else evolves. For the Jew, Word is God. And so, as John writes, he wants to bring the Greeks along, the Gentiles along, so they understand what he's talking about, so that they can wrap their heads around what he's wanting to share with them. In John, we read about the light of the world. We know the light to be Jesus. John says the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There's darkness in the world. There was then, there is now. There are things like hurricanes and floods. There are violence, there's war, there's all kinds of unrest. But the light and the life comes to us in Emmanuel. God is with us, and God has always been with us. The prelude to John's gospel takes us back to the very beginning. It takes us to the first few verses of the Old Testament in Genesis. We remember, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. That's Genesis, and this is John. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Throughout our reading of the Old Testament, we have experienced, we have seen how God seeks to be in relationship with the people, seeks to guide them, seeks to direct them, seeks to always be pulling them back to him. He uses the prophets to do this. And sometimes for a period of time, the people are faithful. They listen, they follow God's ways, and then they turn away. They begin, like we do sometimes, thinking, we know the best way to go. We can do this. We can make this on our own. But then we and they sometimes begin stumbling in the darkness. And God could see that they needed a Savior. And so at the right time, Jesus was born. Now the first chapter of John is really a second creation story, one that tells us of the pre-existence of the cosmic Word, that the Word was with God and the Word was God. And then we read about John the Baptist, about how John came to testify to the light. He wasn't the light himself, but he came to testify to the light. And all who received him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. All who believe in him, the right to become the children of God. And then in verse 14, we read this amazing thing. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. It's Jesus, full of grace and truth. He is the Word made flesh, and he came to live among us, to show us God's way. He came into the world, into this broken world. The Word was made flesh and lives among us. The Word became flesh through Jesus. Now we've been reading over these past 21 weeks about God's people and how astray they have gone, how much they needed a Savior, and how God recognized them and gave them a Savior, gave them the opportunity to rebuild. They were exiled and they came back to Jerusalem. They rebuilt the temple. They rebuilt the walls. We talked about that last week with Nehemiah. They rebuilt the city. And then we come to the end of the Old Testament. Before we begin the New Testament, there's actually a period of 400 years. 400 years where there are other places in charge of them, and there are times when they're greatly oppressed, and there are times when they live in relative freedom. In the time that Jesus was born, they were under Roman rule, and Herod was at the throne. I think it's good and interesting and helpful for us to consider, I mean, how many times have we experienced Christmas in September? In another community that I live, we had Christmas in July, and that was when people went out and there were all kinds of work activities in the community that people from the various churches and from service organizations worked together to make a difference in that community. It was a good thing. It was called Christmas in July, but we're actually doing the Christmas story now. And the really cool thing about that is you're not sitting there thinking about the list of things that you have to do yet, the people who are coming to dinner tonight. You're not looking at the Christmas tree and going, there's something just a little bit off there. If you've been reading the story, you were kind of ready for it. But if you haven't been reading the story, or if you're visiting here today, you're going, well, that's Mary and Joseph and the infant there. We had that up for the architectural tour on Friday evening, and I was thinking, isn't it fun, all the people coming in, what are these Methodists doing, oh my gosh. But it's unexpected now at this time, and I think that's helpful because it was really unexpected to the people at that time. You know, they weren't coming to a particular time of the year when we pull out the Advent hymns and start thinking about what we're doing at Christmas. When they heard rumor that Mary and Joseph were spoken to by an angel, that was the first time. And when the shepherds were out in their fields, that's a brand new, unexpected kind of thing. They didn't. Can you imagine the very first time? That's the Word made flesh in Jesus. The Word was made flesh in Jesus. And sometimes it's helpful for us to think about what that must have been like and not just to have it as a part of our routine. It was an ordinary day. It was an unexpected time, an unexpected place. That the Word was made flesh through Jesus. He pitched a tent and lived among us. He gave us hope. He gave us possibility. He gave us a mission. He gave us a ministry. And so here we are today in this place at this time, and the Word becomes flesh through us. The Word becomes flesh through us. We who are Christians, we who proclaim ourselves to be disciples of Jesus Christ, we as the church, we are the body of Christ in the world. And we tend to think sometimes that we don't have a lot of power, and there's not a whole lot that we can do. But we as a worldwide church, with the power of God, with Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, are amazing. And what we can do and what we can accomplish when we remember who He is and when we seek to follow Him. Every time we speak a word of love and grace, every time each one of us as individuals in whatever setting we are in, wherever we're at, when we speak a word of grace in a world where there is disunity, where there is hatred, we are being the body of Christ in the world. We are a part of the second incarnation. The Word becomes flesh through you. Every time you offer a drink of cold water to one who is alone or lonely, every time you offer food to the hungry, whenever you offer clothing to those who are naked, whenever you visit the sick or the imprisoned, you are a part of the second incarnation. You are the Word made flesh. The Word is made flesh through you. Sometimes it feels as though what we do doesn't make a lot of difference. Sometimes we can't see, we may never see what our words and our actions, what impact they might have on anybody. But we keep on doing them because nothing that we do in Jesus' name is done in vain. You are a part of the second incarnation. The Word becomes flesh through you. Remember that every day, wherever you are. Every day is Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Trusting in Christ's promises and grateful for the Spirit's sustaining power, let us bring our tithes and offering to God. Holy ushers, please wait upon us.
Thank you.
be to God. Go in peace, go in joy, go in love. In Jesus' name, amen.